providing a really nice model of what the temple would have been when it was in more or less in full flower. Actually, they haven't filled in the garden and really very responsive to consider that it was. It's spectacular. And the part over here, there's almost nothing left. When we get up to there, on the edge, we'll see a little bit left of that whole big complex there. But so they know, I guess, there's enough left of the old one. That's the Middle Kingdom temple, and quite unique. And the Hatshepsut temple itself is the work of the genius architect, Senenmut, who was reputedly a lover, which is not established really, but it's a nice story. But he was using as his model this other temple, which is a lesser construction, there, fully restored. It doesn't look that much lesser, actually. But it's kind of like it's not as though, it's more than just a kind of a development of the earlier, but it's sort of like the story of the Porsche I once owned, my one and only last Porsche. And I got from the factory, but I didn't know it was in the army in Germany. And there's a nice little story about it. How many of you know how the Porsche was invented? Anyone? No one. Well, Ferdinand Porsche was the guy who designed the Volkswagen. And when the Volkswagen went into production in 1948 or so, it was a huge success the world over. And he must have been a pretty good boss, because he had also, just for fun, he had drawing board, he'd done a souped-up sports car version of the Volkswagen. And there was no intention of doing anything with it, and on his 75th birthday, all of his workers got together and in secret tooled up one prototype of this sports car version of the Volkswagen. It wasn't today's Porsche, it was a heated up 1100cc engine and so on, but it was pretty awesome today. This was such a huge success among his friends that they went into production, and we have a Porsche today. I had one of those early Porsches. And I don't know, for my 75th birthday, nobody did the goddamn thing. And anyway, there you go. So this is what it actually all looked like when it was in full flower. And it is, we didn't see Sakala yet. So when you look at it, it looks, it's quite different from anything else of the New Kingdom, and remarkably similar to Saqqara, which is full 1,200 years earlier. And it has this really modern look. It looks as though it could have been designed by Frank Lloyd Wright, and which is an odd thing, but it's one of those things that resonated down through history, because when the architects of the Bauhaus, mostly German and Austrian architecture, looking for a way out of Victorian clutter at the beginning of the 19th century, they went back to Egypt, not to Greece and Rome, which had been the models for, you know, the classic period of the 18th century, for their inspiration. And Hatshepsut's temple was just in stumps. I mean, it's mostly restored, you'll see when you get there. So it has, you know, it reaches forward. It's not that what we do today, the best of what we do today, has echoes of this. It's that this is a kind of a prototype, a model for a little bit that we do today that's of any good at all. Most of it, of course, is Walmarts and garbage. Okay, so that's a bit of temple wrap. When we go up here, we'll give everybody some time, because it's great, it's empty. Say 20 minutes, and when you go up here, and I'll talk a little bit more about Kathy's reincarnational adventure when we report back. You go up the first ramp, it's not stairs, it's a ramp. And then when we get to the second level, on one side, we'll totally show you when we get up there. Yeah. We'll take about 20 minutes.
In the middle level, and then when you are on your own, you can go up and check out the top.
Let's go. Just to continue, it'll only take a minute or so. with the Kathy's reincarnation story about you know, being here as a young boy. And so she said, you know, that it was all green and so on. And here, in fact, are the stumps of the trees that Hatshepsut brought back from her expedition, probably to Somalia. We'll see it graphically represented in one of the in the temple itself. And she also said it was very interesting because the next day was an off day or half an off day. So we jumped in a cab and came back here because she said that she remembered living in a little village that was just over the way this way. And so we went to check, and sure enough, there was still a little village there, very impoverished, a couple of little hovel type things. But she also remembered a lot other details, and she said that she was talking about over there, we see all of that rubble has fallen down. It's called talus, has crumbled off the cliff face itself. And she said it wasn't like that. She said it was like, and they were cutting a cave and, you know, something into the face of the cliff. And I realized that was potentially very interesting because the academics haven't thought that this is an accumulation of 3,500 years, and that at one point or another it wouldn't have been there. So obviously what she was visiting, it was very clear what she saw. It was clearly a tomb, and virtually certainly that tomb will have been plundered somewhere along the line. It's at ground level. But if we had the time, and it wouldn't be the top priority, we had the time and the money to go exploring a bit, the seismographs would tell us in 2 seconds if there were unexplored, undiscovered tombs cut into the cliff face behind the talus. And that in turn would be a very good instance of psychic archaeology being demonstrated, which is in fact rather a big deal. So anyhow, so these are the trees, stumps of the trees are probably more flooding
two of
around
them.
Somewhere. There are two, but if you dug enough you probably would find other things. Other
clinic.
Things underground. So
this is a clinic.
So
myrrh tree is for
this was
a healing temple for Hathoris here too.
Healing temple, yes.
Somebody told me the last time that it was also a hospice where people came to die.
Oh, really?
Yeah. One part was hospital, one part was hospice.
Well, that makes perfect
right.
sense.
For Anubis is one side and Hatshepsut and Hathor is another.
We'll talk about that after our free time.
So what time is it?
This way, the way I'm facing. Yeah, in fact, I'll get over here so you can see, because that's the best of the Hathor faces that's been restored, but it probably wasn't too ruinous to begin with. And it is, as I said, it is completely anomalous to normal Egyptian iconography. So you don't see the god's full face that way. Thank you. And it's restored, but it's basically the face of Hatshepsut, and that follows actually throughout Egypt, throughout the course of Egypt, that the queen is the living Hathor, just as the king is the living Horus, and sometimes, but not always, when they're doing the face of Hathor, the face of Horus is always shown, of course, as a falcon, so they can do that. But the face of Hathor is the face of whoever is queen. We'll see that in Abu Simbel, we have Nefertari. But this is a particularly good face. But this one up here especially.
Intact.
Really is intact. And you see, and I can't tell, it doesn't look like it to me, but like I was just looking at the others, that one certainly not. Where they have the egg in the ear. Mm-hmm. That's another interesting study, that when sometimes the egg is in the ear and sometimes it isn't in the air. And that's for sure deliberate and has something to do with the deeper meaning or the context of that particular Hathor. And here also, you see, this is a very strange and unique little chapel here. And it's very beautiful and it's peaceful. And it's packed with these strange columns that are unlike anything else. The ones that are the octagonal, not octagonal there, whatever 16 is there. Anyway, the 16-sided columns right behind Carlos there. Why a 16-sided column? I have absolutely no idea. Some of the others are square, some of the others are round. The round ones here are really the totality of Hathor symbolism, because they represent, or they're in the shape of a musical instrument called a sistrum, which is exactly that. We'll see actual sistrums. In fact, some places you can buy bad reproductions of them. And the top part has, when it's an instrument, it has kind of like a, what are they? Not castanets. Not banjos. What is it? The instrument that goes. Yeah, the rattle. But what's the name of it? Castanets? No.
Maracas.
What? Maracas. Yeah, they sound like maracas, but they're not. They're, when they're metal bangles on a frame drum. There's a name to that frame drum. What?
Tambourine?
No. Yeah, I think it is a tambourine, yeah. Anyway, it's like that, and it is, but it is, it has a shaft to it, and it goes. So it has a celebratory function. And the, as you know, if Hathor is the, if the face of Hathor is the uterus, then, I mean, this is an actual, looks like an actual instrument. But at the top part here, you see, on some of them, but not on all of them, you see the rearing cobras with the sun discs in the head, with the solar discs in the head, almost certainly, when you have it in a context like that, representing the risen Kundalini energy. And then, when it's sexual symbolism, is that it's the entire vaginal, the whole reproductive thing, all in one instrument, with the shaft as the canal, and the head as the uterus. And the John theory is that the serpents at the top represent orgasm. Makes perfect sense. Anyway, I like it. If you don't, well, you don't have to. So, but otherwise, this little hall itself, it's known that it was a chapel, a healing chapel, but it really, how was it used? Well, what's the point of all of these closely packed columns? I have absolutely no idea. Another good PhD study, because to the best of my knowledge, nobody's really approached it and asked that particular question. Anyway, so, and, oh, by the way, I should say that a friend of mine has written a terrific novel about, almost no novels about ancient Egypt have the ring of truth about them. And this is one of the very rare ones by a woman named Maria Isabel Pita, who is the daughter of a terrific Cuban poetess, who I think is still alive. I've lost touch with her, she'd be about my age. And Maria's novel is called, self-published, is called A Truth is the Soul of the Sun, which is a lovely title, but it's also an exact translation of Hatshepsut's throne name, which is Matkara, which is exactly truth is the soul of the sun. And it really has a ring of truth about it. It's long, and it's detailed, but it really captures the heat and the eroticism and the esotericism of ancient Egypt. It's a rare book. So write it down in your memory. It's on my website, actually, in the reading list.
What, say the name again?
Her name is Maria Isabel Pita.
And the book?
And the book is called Truth is the Soul of the Sun. Well worth getting. It's really good. And it would also make a very good movie. It would really be a terrific movie.
Would you come in here, please, John?
What?
Me? John?
This is beautiful in the chapel, the color.
What?
John.
Oh, yeah.
Wait. Hey, John,
yes.
Just one moment.
Sure. What's that?
We just looked at this, and the Hathor face is missing, but that looks like legs and the hips.
Yeah, when you take the detail away from face and just sort of
the whole thing just looks
look
like
at the form,
wow. The form of the
what
torso
it
and
does,
the legs.
Yeah, you mean with the head, this thick.
Well, if the head is the reproductive organs, look at the waist right above that, and then it expands.
The hair is the legs.
Yeah.
Wow.
Maybe. This is certainly better than any explanation I've seen up to now, because I've always wondered about that. obviously it's a wig that she's wearing. Mm-hmm. But
when you but take that away, has,
yeah, that's very.
A woman standing.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that's, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's very observant. It could well be that. Because otherwise it's
serialism.
Otherwise it's
in
otherwise
a different
it's,
way of art.
Yeah.
Otherwise it's sort of inexplicable. What does I mean everything means something, so what is that very thickly braided thing? That's good. Yeah. I like that one. That will be now be
would that makes sense
with
the
that will now be done with Donna's head. Right? Yeah. That's right. What's that?
I was thinking at the other temple that would make sense with eggs in the ears.
Right, I mean, it makes the location.
That's another interesting study. Why is that? Why are there eggs in the ears sometimes, and sometimes not? Obviously, when there are eggs in the ears, it's a stage in the process. But when it doesn't have eggs in the ears, does that mean it's later in the process or before that?
Think of an ear canal, right, that goes into the sinuses and a fallopian tube that goes down into the uterus.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
They're both. Exits. I mean, even for like bloody matter.
Well,
your estation tubes run.
Yeah, this could be. This could well be. What's that?
So good observation.
Yeah,
saw that. That's Dr. Adana.
When you have a room, you see how beautifully colored this chapel is. It's also part of Hathor's chapel for Hatshepsut. One side there is Amun and the other side is Hathor. But inside, in a small niche in below there, you have to dig for it. Then you find a small character of her lover, Sinenmut.
Supposedly her lover.
Yeah, well, the architect who did this temple. But you see, the workers or the architects don't sign their names on art, except for two in the whole history.
Right.
Right? So here is Sinenmut represented down there. And check out the color. Then I'd like you to notice also those two walls. There is also some color here. And here she is, Hatshepsut. Look at her face. Even with the beard, you'd see a feminine face over there. And she was wearing the atif, which is the war crown, although she hasn't been to war. So you see here, look at the warriors. Look, this is some of the Egyptian army. They hold the olive tree, that's peace, huh? And here, I love this scene because she has her hand out where Hathor, look, she's licking her fingers. It's like her own pet. What a connection. See? Look at also her. She looks back. They look to each other. Right? And of course, this is all happening on a line of amazing jet pillars with Ankh and the basket.
And
look, there is the yellow and the red.
They're always actually yellow. Red is masculine. Yellow is feminine. And there's some endocrinal reason for that. The masculine, it's what is it? Hemoglobin, iron in the blood that's, you know, associated with
testosterone.
Mars and so on, like testosterone. And there's some reason why the yellow has something to do with estrogen.
Much
or
less of that hormone in women makes it yellow. Then it's a symbolic.
That's why they're scared of everything. Anyway. Also, you notice, I mean, even in the 30 years that I've been coming here, these things have deteriorated to a considerable extent. But you see the delicacy of the work. It's as though the glyphs have been almost washed across the surface of the stone. Compare it to Ramses the Second, where these things are hammered in, and actually we don't get to the Ramesseum, which is the mortuary temple of Ramses III. You can't do everything in one day. But there, in certain instances, they're hammered about, I mean, nearly a foot, the hieroglyphs are hammered into the stone, nearly a foot. And the usual explanation is, well, they only did it that Ramses III saw that everybody else was having their hieroglyphs effaced, so he wanted to make sure they couldn't efface his. This is complete bullshit, because elsewhere the things aren't effaced. There's some reason why, and it is in keeping with this organic process of starting out, as it does in the Italian Renaissance, with Giotto's simple and geometrical and uncluttered, and then it gets more and more complex and complicated until it becomes Baroque and Rococo and degenerate. So this is the earliest stages of the New Kingdom, and it's in keeping that it is both exquisitely executed, but very, very undramatic, as it were, and very, let's say, underemphasized, but just so subtle, yes, subtle.
And also, you notice the rattle of Hathor. So, see, she's wearing one. So there was really a toy rattle, they used it. Really? So here she wears it as a coral. But even when it's painted, it's still shining, there is still color. After all those years, this is like a 1470 BC temple.
And by the way, did you notice the cow that is Hathor? So have you noticed the cows as we've been going through? They're exactly the same breed.
I've seen a few of those.
And some
this
of them,
time.
Not the water buffalo, but the cattle, the much clearly the same. They're not, you know, they're not Holsteins, and they're not like the ones that we have around.
They're lying down.
Mm-hmm. They're sacrificial.
Yeah, and those like the leg of.
But that's not a cow. You think it's more a different species with horns, big horns on.
It's blood. It's rubber and blood. It's also the mixing of the yellow. It's plasma. It's the serum that carries the blood. Right, and there's even blue, like venous blood, on the way back when they combine.
Could be. Yeah, maybe. But I mean, the yellow is definitely feminine.
Sure, but I mean, if you think about like yellow clotting serum, right? That's the
absolutely
part that heals. This is a healing temple.
Oh, it is a healing temple, right? Indeed. Hathor is both.
Yeah, this is a healing temple, but everywhere, no matter where you go, you have the red and the yellow, even though it's not a healing
All right, maybe they just have good access. Let's go to the other side. Let's go to Pum.
No other reason.
Everyone, did you see Hatshepsut suckling from the cow's udder? See? She's having the divine milk. I'd love to.
Hey, John, that one was all effaced out there, except for the head, which is unusual.
Which one?
The one we were looking at.
Well, with Hatshepsut, that's different. Nobody touched it.
By the way, You see, do you remember in Oxford Temple, the optical nerves, right? And right and left, and left is right, right? So look at the cows here. They are in front, right? You can see their front stomach side. Why? If you go on the other side, they are giving you their back, the same ones. So it's an indication of that thing of the visual.
Going from east to west.
Right. I love this thing.
Anyway, over here, there's certainly a science of offering. Somebody should get into why certain things are like one tableau, because the tableaus are never the same. There's some reason why they're individualized. This is Amon, and we haven't seen an Amon as clear as this one up to now. And you see, his strange headdress, as they always say, is a double-plumed headdress. It has nothing to do with plumes. No one ever saw a plume like that. They're divided into, each half is 14 different sections. So you get 28 altogether, which is a lunar, something that has a lunar contact. And as I said earlier, they never found any physical representations or examples of any of the headdress. It's a big mystery. Must have some way to the consciousness that aspect of
And of course, Hatshepsut was standing right under the neck bit of the vulture for whatever she's having from her. She's been totally erased. See? The temple has been erased.
We'll talk about when we go out a bit.
Right. Do you want to see the other side? Look at the ceiling too. This is the enormous chapel.
Anubis, by the way, is in his jackal form, associated with embalming, and in his associated wipwawet form, looking more greyhoundy, as the guide through the underworld. And again, the reason why is the jackal chosen for that role? One, jackal is an eater of carrion, in other words, turning dead flesh into sustenance for himself. And the other is that a jackal, like a dog, is very good at finding its way home in the dark and through the wilderness and so on. So it's an ideal animal for that particular role. And in fact, all of the ancient civilizations did that. They chose the animals and totems. In American Indians, some of them have the bear, and some of them have the wolf, and some of them have the wolverine as their totem. That it sort of expresses their own personality and consciousness. So all you have to do is know what the habits of that particular creature, bee or bird or whatever, and you've got a good inkling. I mean, it's very sensible because you have a good inkling as to what that principle represents, or as to the inner workings of the principle. You don't have to go through a lot of intellectual abstraction. You just have it, wolf, owl, whatever.
Anyway, the jackal takes carrion and transforms it into living sustenance,
yes.
And then, it's the transformation, huh?
Yeah, so it's...
As clear as that.
It's a very early, let's say, and very humane and very enlightened hospice, because you go to get healed at the Hathor chapel, and if it doesn't work, there's Anubis to speed you on without having to go through a lot of grief and pain and so on. I mean, I'm sure
and
it still was
a pleasant process. It's always involved in mummification, and it's the guide to the underworld.
And actually, now that everyone else is gone, I talk rather than out in the hot sun, there's big mystery about
Hatshepsut's, her transgression, as it were, because she wasn't recognized as legit, and yet she, her stepson, Thutmose, right? Sahila?
Yes.
Thutmose is her stepson. And he's off, as they often call him, the Napoleon of Egypt, but he wasn't, because Napoleon was really a mean dude, and physically very unappealing, and Thutmose III looked like a great poet and mystic. But he was out carving out the empire to the east, and he was there for years and years and years, and Hatshepsut took on the role of pharaoh, which was, for whatever reason, not legit. And then it's thought that Thutmose came back, and when Hatshepsut either died or got displaced, no one's really sure, he took over and went about effacing her image just about everywhere, but not everywhere. And he really wanted to do it everywhere, but he left buildings intact and so on, which is different than Akhenaten. When they got rid of him, they razed everything but everything to the ground. On the other hand, even more to the point, is that whoever rules the army rules the country. This is from time immemorial. So Thutmose was out there in the east as a warrior in control of the army, and he didn't take the trouble to go back to Egypt, which was, you know, easy to do. It was not as though it was on the Mars. Claim his title as pharaoh. So he could have done that, but he didn't, because and Hatshepsut's reign was one of the most peaceful and prosperous of the entire
kingdom.
New kingdom, yeah. And then there was a book, one of the books I consulted, and it's in the guidebook, book in French, called Le Problème de la Reine Hatshepsut. And it was a French Egyptologist, I forget her name, Suzanne Ratier, who looked into the reasons behind the wholesale effacement, and had six different opinions, official, you know, academic opinions, which she destroyed in turn very effectively, and then gave her own alternative opinion, which I destroyed in turn. Very easy. So the lesson is that we still don't know why the effacement happened, really exactly who did it. Might not have been Thutmose, even in academia, they're talking about this. But very interesting, because she did all of this great stuff. My guess is that she was fine to reign as queen with all of the queenly attributes and all the queenly powers, but it was taking on the masculine role that was the no-no that made her, that was responsible for the subsequent campaigns against her. And sometimes you'll see that her ka is left okay. Ka, they always call the double. The ka is really the personality, her psychological essence. That was okay. It was it was the act that got it, that, as I said, inspired the campaign against her. But we'll see elsewhere when you go to Karnak and elsewhere that there's a lot of Hatshepsut material around, and that they do, in fact, reconstruct some of it as, you know, as money and money permits. Anyway.
Let's go to that.
Since we have it here in the shade, let me go through a couple of other things and then the hot sun. I mean, the sun is not...
No, I've noticed an empty cartouche up there.
What?
An empty cartouche, so...
Really?
Right in the middle, on top of the wing disc, yellow. And anyway, you will see that it's so prominent, the yellow here, emphasizing she was the she, since you saw her with the beard, huh? The artificial beard, the royal beard. She was represented as the man, and that maybe has created the whole mess of the thing.
We'll see.
Taken away the cartouche from here, or many cartouches have Thutmose's third name instead of hers, they, you know, substituted it, or they just took the syllable that shows that it's her, you know. So the name in here for Hatshepsut isn't really prominent and normally as left as it is. But also her figure.
Also, when we go to the where they have the voyage to Punt, there are a few columns. A lot of it's pretty badly effaced, but there are a few places in which she's showing herself as Pharaoh and all the rest of it. But everything is in yellow, so she's not trying to disguise her femininity, which is really unusual that you see something like that. So big problem still there, but it doesn't really impinge upon the quest. The central issue of the quest for immortality is what really interests me. These historical facts are sort of fun, but they don't make an awful lot of difference. Like now they're looking, maybe they've got Nefertiti's tomb or something referring to Nefertiti behind Tutankhamun's tomb, and it doesn't really matter, but it keeps them occupied and from doing more damage, so maybe it's a good thing. Anyway,
you enjoyed the color.
Oh yeah, the colors. You see the starfish on the ceiling.
The cobras with Hathor head. So those are the nicer cobras, because when we go to the Valley of the Kings, you will see other kind of snakes. And here you see a most beautiful line, amazing in color, and it's raised, almost washed over, like the thickness of a paper. And then the cartouche is empty, so it was a title or Jetta, the eternal one on earth, the praised one, the heart of Osiris. Look at the jet pillar. To give in life the beloved Lord, the brave one, Ipu, I don't know what's in Npu, in Karnak maybe. And then the cartouche is empty. Huh? And here is another one, the title and the cartouche is empty.
Yeah,
so.
That's interesting.
Osiris is standing here.
Two more things, couple things. One is here, right in front of the completely effaced Hatshepsut image, is this strange thing on a pole.
There's one
with the goatskin. Yeah, another one that's associated with funerary practices. It's supposed to be a goatskin filled with some sort of grease or unguent, lard or something. What it's doing here, I don't know. Why is it? This is a little PhD study, not really a major one.
I heard that it also represents Osiris.
Maybe, but what? Why?
It's a big fence, though.
Yeah, it looks like that too. Well, everything looks like that.
It's like John. It looks like the thing that's in the hospital where they're dripping, fluids into a person's body. Intravenous.
Well,
it's planted in a human pot to keep it stable.
Not the same, but it maybe it has something to do. It's the same principle, maybe, could be. Then this is the temple itself. The whole temple is a kind of number symbolist paradise, as it were, because there are a lot of features in here that are really very, very unusual. Some of which I can account for. If you count the columns of the main parts there, you'll see that they're in double banks of 11 columns each. This is not casual, Why do 11 columns? The even numbers are sort of the easiest to deal with. You're dealing with 11s, and I think the reason is 11 is a number often associated with Hathor, 4, 6, sometimes 7, but more often 11, and this represents, she's mistress of the cycles of time, is a number associated with cycles because the Egyptians expressed pi, or they had a number of ways of expressing pi, 3.1417, etc., as the best you can do in whole numbers is 22 over 7. Very interesting, actually, 7 being the number of process or growth, and 22 being a number associated with the total circle, because that's their expression of pi. So, and Hathor is the mistress of the cycles of time. So it's written into, it's written into the columns of the temple itself, which resonates. Even if we didn't know that, this temple doesn't look like any other temple. It has its own serious thing to it, but for understanding that there's always, always, always some good inner reason why they have X number of columns. And usually you can, it's pretty easy. You see fives, you see eights, it's for Osiris, you see fours, and you see 12s for the 12 hours a day and night. But 11 was sort of baffling until I realized, or someone pointed out to me, I don't remember, that this is associated, this is a circular number. And the seven, in fact, there are iconographically, we'll see it. There are the seven Hathors who are often shown banging their frame drums, celebrating a birth or whatever. So it represents what Schwaller calls the primordial scission. In other words, the division of the whole into two, which is the first stage of manifestation. So it's written into this temple, as it were, the sevens aren't here, but it's the 22s are, and actually you can even see the whole temple as, if you want to do it, it's not just occurring to me, as the scission. In other words, it's that which divides the circle of infinity in which nothing is manifest into the manifest. There's a deep teaching, yeah, in creation. There's a teaching enshrined in all of that. Okay, let us go and see if the voyage to Punt is grapple free. We are doing very well.
Ooh, that's hot. You're good with that?
Yeah, I'm fine. Okay. Sure.
Everyone?
Here, let me get out of the way.
Hatshepsut, she spent her 20 very peaceful years of ruling Egypt building and actually adding, and there was a lot of economy going on with Africa and otherwise. This is the very famous trip here when she sent her fleet, the Egyptian fleet, from the Red Sea down to Somalia. The boats, that's why they are sewn boats, they go to the closest Kuft. You remember when we drove yesterday until Kuft, a few kilometers from Luxor. Kuft is a shortest distance from it to the Red Sea. So they would dismantle the boats on donkey or whatever to the Red Sea shores, build the boats and go down and up. Then here it shows what happened, or they describe what, you know, the trip. The boats below is the ones, the Egyptian boats on the Red Sea, like look at the sea, with the different kinds of fish and lobster and turtles and everything. So they reached Somalia, and here they are loading the boat with myrrh trees. Look at the gangplank on top. And the Egyptians have baskets full of goodies. And here they emphasize the myrrh trees. There is even baboon on a sail over here. This is the Egyptian fleet. And here is the leader of this mission with Egyptians behind. And this is the Somalian prince or ruler. They have, look at how much gold is there. So they have, the Egyptians take gold. Look at the beads, the strings lying there, and the circles. Then also some axes and daggers. It was very nice the way they look at his hands up like that. Very peaceful and beautiful. On top, you see a big pile in red with more circles in a basket that's gold. The pile is henna, dyeing the hair. And henna also has some medical, a lot of medical qualities. Now, here is the lady. We are not so sure if she was really sick. John believes she was sick. And she came to see the Egyptian doctor to heal her. Yeah, she has elephantiasis. The original block is now in the museum. It's been stolen several times. Now it's in the museum. And in this line, the Egyptian artist was actually making fun, sorry, of her. He's saying, Hemet, blah, blah, she must have been the wife of this prince. Poor little donkey has to carry this womb. That's how it's written. In here you see the growing trees. You will see that on the water they build bungalows. You see the pillars that carry, and that's coconut tree. We don't have coconut in Egypt. And in order to go home, there is a ladder. There is a donkey here. Where is the donkey? Sorry, a dog. There is a very famous dog. Here is a turtle. They are grazing. Where is the donkey?
Up there, to your right.
Oh, look at him. In red background, under the myrrh tree. That's a, you know, decent dog, wise dog. So this is all Somalia, and we learned a lot of Somalia then. Okay. Then the trip is loaded. Look at...
Hold on a second. With the queen, the sick queen, the reason that she's in there almost certainly is that the Egyptians have this well-deserved reputation as healer, and so they're bringing out this woman stricken with elephantiasis for the Egyptians to heal. And Schwaller, you know, who is deep into heraldry and all of those sorts of things, points to a similar, I think it's called the Eisenstein something, altarpiece. It's a 13th or 14th century early medieval painting of some monastery, and they have a kind of brilliant painting of somebody who has ergot that you get from infected flour, rye bread.
Right.
And the reason for that, says Schwaller, that they show that as a painting is that's a signal to people who are illiterate and can't read of that they know how to handle, they know how to heal that particular disease at that particular monastery. So in other words, it's a kind of a teaching that goes resonating down through the ages.
When you are sick with ergot, how do you look like?
It'll come out in all kinds of terrible spots and stuff.
Oh, really?
Yeah, something like that. What?
Allergic rashes.
Yeah, right. Ah. It's fatal. It's not fooling around.
So here, then, you see the Egyptians are on the gangplank loading their boat with, you see here, the myrrh in baskets. Then they will set off to Egypt. Let's see the trip back to Egypt with all the good Somalian merchandise or things. Look at the squid and lobster.
Yeah.
And we are very famous.
And you see what the boats, the big boats looked like when they didn't have cabins and had all of the guys rowing. Mm-hmm. You can see that a huge boat you could put and set in motion with that.
All right, now over here, look at the end of the Red Sea. You see, a line. They were very, what do you call it, John? Like the end of the sea, here is one line, very definite. Then here is the Ka. Look at those two raised arms on this figure. It's the Ka of Hatshepsut. So she's totally gone, but you still see her contour. But they left the Ka alone. Now, Hatshepsut was standing, displaying the whole list of shopping as she got it. You see giraffes. What is the point? That's a good one here. It's better than this one. Okay, here is the giraffe. Look. See? But the head is gone. Giraffes, cheetahs or leopards. These are ostrich eggs in a basket. Bows. Right, cattle, a lot of cattle. Do you see how much leopard skin? See how much? Because the priest, the high priest, wear cheetah skin, yeah? So they got that, myrrh trees, cattle grazing, and there are, Celesta,
yes.
There are some liquid jars brought from there. So I think it's kind of like oils, essential oils, to heal, or who knows, maybe. But it's very interesting that they got also those liquids from there into those pots. More gold, there is a lot of gold coming. All right, so all this came with beautiful ebony boxes. Look how many boxes there were, loaded with the little stuff. And always the good stuff is in little size. Then here is the henna. And they're measuring. So look at the scale. There is a scale here weighing the cattle. Again, it's gold. Look. It's kind of like of inventory or bookkeeping, right? And this happens, and the great bookkeeper, as Jehuti, writing down all what was there to be listed. This whole thing was presented as offerings to, by her, look at her, as a man but no beard, to that, you see the head of the ram, this is Amun Ra, because that's his sacred animal, right? So that's the end of the trip.
No, actually, you know, to add an element to that, that normally in most other temples, the exterior facade would be the king subduing his enemies. In other words, the victory of the forces of light over the forces of darkness. Here, and I think this is quite deliberate. It's also, it's completely unique. There's nothing quite like it. Hatshepsut is kind of honoring her femininity in that the same message is transmitted by basically bringing back raw materials from Africa and transforming them into, alchemizing them as it were, into a higher level of being, as it were, and that's deliberate. That's why do that when everybody else has them smiting enemies and so on. So that's a John theory. And just down here is one instance.
Yeah.
There are probably others.
Here, this one?
Right here behind you.
Yeah. Holy yes.
I'm not sure who that is.
Amun Ra.
Yeah, I know that. Is that the queen,
of course.
Is that the queen?
Yeah, this one is queen, that's holding queen. And care.
And you see, this is the god himself, Amun. Amun Ra is all in yellow. That's, as far as I know, unique. Nobody like that. Elsewhere, I don't know of any.
Okay. Yalla, you know?
Yalla.
Is there a break in here?
No, but what? Sahila, did you ever notice?
Sahila?
Yeah,
here.
Did you ever notice that right ahead of us is this black granite square?
No, it's not granite. It's the same color. It's the same.
Something?
Yeah. Is it? It's the same stone, but I don't know why is it black. Oh, look, they're all in the bottom. See?
Oh.
So maybe there was a whole tooth and bottom in black.
Yeah.
Yes?
Look, you see it down at the bottom of those stones?
Right.
There's
right.
A little line of black.
So it was all in black.
It goes straight up to the border here.
Right.
Yeah.
Black is a very significant color.
I've only been here 100 times.
But we have to notice this stuff.
No, it's really funny as well.
Yeah.
Oh, there's an extra.
Yeah, okay. Let's go. They do not don't know who. There's always another king. You can tell.
The weighing of the heart
one of the few, the only one I actually know of, it's hard to imagine that it's the only one, of weighing of the heart as a sculpted relief in good detail, so there's enough we can talk about a little bit. And so this, who knows what was here before, if the workers' village is functioning from Ramesside period on, it means that the village is operational for a good 1,000 years before they build this temple. So maybe it's built, as are so many temples, on the something left over from somebody, something else, which would be an interesting thing to go looking for. And it's obviously in pretty good shape. If you look outside, some of it is repair work, but a lot of it is original. And you see the very pronounced waves of the courses that are laid down as if they were waves of, you know, of water, or in other words, energy. That's all there. And what we'll do, in fact, is go take a look at the at the weighing of the heart and explain it a bit. And which time all of these guys should have left from inside, and maybe we can do a couple of minutes of meditation and maybe a chant here. And it's wonderfully quiet, and that's really, if I stop talking and they stop talking, it's really not really.
So John, give me all this.
This scaffolding has been here for at least 4 years.
Wow.
At least, maybe more.
There's a syringe up there. And that's probably,
oh, cool.
No, up here.
With the two of them.
With the cotton balls.
With the cotton balls.
What are they doing?
They're irrigation syringes.
I don't know, that's why it's been here for so long.
Oh, here? What are you talking about?
Probably.
These are irrigation syringes.
Yeah, solid.
Which is the syringe?
This is a real one.
Oh, it's not a real one.
No, a real one.
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
They're irrigation syringes.
Imagine what's going on in here.
I think they're for rinsing up tooth holes.
Anyway, okay, now here's the judgment, the weighing of the heart on this side behind you. Now, maybe you want to get in behind you there. Take a look.
Where's the scales?
Here are the scales.
Oh, right.
And there's the heart, or the symbol of the heart, and there's the feather of Mott, which represents equilibrium, justice, law, etc., etc., etc. The idea is that the heart cannot be heavier than the feather. It would last all of us up, by God. And if you fail, if the heart is heavier than the feather, you're in deep shit, because your ka, your ba, I forget which one it is, and the ka gets thrown to this nasty looking fellow here called Amit, the eater of the dead. It's part crocodile and part hippo and part tail. Is I'm not sure what that is. That's a lion, maybe a lion. Anyway, so that your heart gets eaten, and that is, I'm not sure, because Egypt talks about the two deaths, the first death and the second death. And I think the first death, you can, sort of like Christian purgatory, you can, in the afterlife, make good whatever went wrong and whatever you did wrong. But the second death is when, that might be with either of the dead, where it's irreparable. I mean, with Donald Trump or something. And, I mean, so your heart gets eaten by Amit, and that's the end of your, you no longer, not only do you not exist any longer, but your memory, your name, your existence has been expunged, just as though you never lived.
Wow.
This is hard.
That's
but you do have this second chance, and so on. And so anyway, this is, here Jehuti thought wisdom is recording the verdict over here. This guy's probably going to make it because he's a pharaoh, so who knows. And up above here are the 42, each of these with the feather on his head,
are the 42 assessors, the 42 judges, and this is the so-called negative confession. I don't know whether that's written here or not, but anyway, that's what it is. And this is basically negative confession because you say, I didn't do this, I didn't do that, I didn't do the other. It's all negative in that sense. And there are some good ones in there that should have found its way into the Ten Commandments, which is probably the forerunner. There's one that basically says, I did not meddle in my neighbor's business. That should be the 11th commandment, or maybe the first of the whole bunch. And as I said, this is Ptolemaic, but it's exactly very high, a high order of Ptolemaic relief work compared to, say, Dendera, which is much cruder. And you know, it's really cool because you go to all of these different temples, and all of them consecrated in one way or another to quest for immortality. But only this one that I know of. But as I said, I think it's likely they are somewhere else. But you have the weighing of the heart depicted. Other than that, some other interesting stuff here. Here we didn't get a chance really to look at it, but here's a good representation of this strange boat of Sokar, in which this craft, looking rather like a crescent moon, and I find it hard to imagine that that's not deliberate, with the oars over there, the steering oars, very different from the steering oars, a solar boat, and I guess these are oars here, but they're very strange-looking oars. And then the gazelle looking backwards, and the bull looking forwards, and the head of Sokar with the solar disk on his head, and it's got a portcullis. Well, I guess this is a gate, kind of a crate that holds the bark in place. It's being towed on a sledge, and maybe one of you guys will have nothing else to do one of these days and Google up boat of Sokar and see if you can find anything intelligible about it. I'd be willing to bet that if I looked, I'd find it, but it just isn't directly, doesn't impinge directly upon what I'm doing, so I just don't get around to doing it. A couple of cool Anubises up there.
Kyle, if you want to take your hand off.
Yes, you're not supposed to touch because, you know, if two, let's say three people touch this, exactly where you're touching, at the end of 1,000 years, you would have worn a small patch into the wall. So, and on the boundary. And here, there's Osiris, because this is the court of Osiris. That's all that's Osiris over there, on the throne. And over there, Osiris again, holding both the flail and the crook. In a particular position that certainly has some significance or the other. Behind them is the Hathor, or I'm not sure if that's Hathor, or Isis. Should be Isis, I would think. Yeah, it's not Hathor, I don't see her name in the square. So that would be Isis, but wearing the Hathor crown. Why, I don't know. This would be whatever Ptolemy this is, offering incense to Osiris, hoping that Osiris forgives a life of debauchery and all of the rest of the stuff up in Alexandria, which describes most of them. And other things of interest. Oh, over here, interesting, this is Amon in his ithyphallic form with erect phallus. At the point of the navel, not at the point of genitals, because this is symbolic impregnation rather than actual physical impregnation. And Amun Min in this form, M-I-N, and he's holding a kind of a four, like forked stick over his head, And it's thought the Greeks associated with him that he's got one arm. That's another part of a weird myth that I don't really believe. That, anyway, I won't even bother to go into it. But the Greeks associated him with Jupiter and his thunderbolt, which is probably more or less correct. That, you know, he represents procreation, but also at another level, punishment. And what he's doing, what exactly he's doing in the same room as the book of, you know, as the weighing of the heart, I'm not sure, but there's certainly a coherence to the entire sequence. Over here you have Anubis playing his frame drum, and the king waving an incense. That's what that's doing there. He's, you know, showing cartoon form, showing waving the incense form to get the incense burner, the censer, to you know, to send out its perfume. And interestingly enough, we'll see in Dendera, it won't be Anubis playing the frame drum, it'll be the seven Hathors with their frame drum. And this is quite late. There's an interesting book by a friend of mine who died a few years ago called When the Women Were Drummers, because if you go back far enough, the musicians, in fact, were mostly women, and often shown playing the frame drums, which of course they still use to this day. What this one is here with the four ram heads on the ram, I do not know. And the vulture, I think neck bed, the vulture. There, this is a total mystery to me, but I'm pretty sure it's known well enough. I may even have it in the guidebook and I forgot it myself, I don't know. Anyhow, this is a cool scene, and
what's the second heart doing on the scale?
What's that?
The fact that there are two hearts on the scale is confusing, because the actual scale is only weighing one of them, and the other is hanging down by the center.
I think that is, that's the counterweight.
Yeah.
Whatever you do with an actual scale, it has a counterweight that adjusts the thing.
Why are they both holding the scales?
What's that?
Why are they both holding the scales and not letting them balance themselves?
You gotta level them first,
yeah. I'm not sure. Probably, yeah. Probably they have to get it. They have to get it absolutely level, and then turn it loose.
Because it's an image of the judgment. If they were, if the scales was being weighed, like they're not telling you what's happening. They're telling you what's,
yeah.
You know? Because if their hands were off of it, that would say, oh yes, he is good or he isn't.
That's a good point.
We'll be the judge of this.
Yeah,
yeah,
the action hasn't happened yet.
Good point, Jane. Yeah. Yes. I like that. Good point.
It's all the same.
Hmm?
They look like they're the same.
Sort of. Let's see.
Yeah, they do.
Where's the elbow?
Yeah.
Yeah, they're even.
They're pretty even.
Yeah.
The stick is crooked. Okay, let's go briefly into the next room.
Joe, what's this third flower?
Wait.
Man. You played that with
it? No, I was smoking.
Yeah.
The first couple of weeks, I was like, trying to smoke more. I tasted disgusting. I couldn't get it. It was easier. Especially that first one. It was so good. And watching, also because I was watching the receptors, it keeps the part of your brain.
Sila?
Sila.
Sila. Sila. Sila. I forget the other one.
This one's Sila.
Who's? Sila. Sila. I forget who's who in here.
You
know better than I do.
That's a Munra.
Yeah, I knew
of
that.
Of course. This one is, who's, what is Carlos?
Behind you. 1 second. There you go.
You have this one, I think, no, I want the light. Thank you. This is mood, because look, I see mood.
There you go.
Ah, right.
Right? And she wears the double crown. Who else? Mm-hmm. You see?
Right.
Wear it, neb it, in the city. Hem it. I think they are referring to mood.
That's
this
pita.
Is, of course,
pita?
Is it pita or khonsu?
Oh, khonsu.
Oh, that's the triad.
Triad. Mood.
Okay? Yeah. So, mood,
khonsu.
Khalas, this is one. Now, here is Hathor, here is her name.
Right.
Then here is Maat.
Right.
And this is a queen. Her name is Elson. Look. E-L. Alexandra, something. She's the wife of Ptolemy IV.
All the kings. I bet it's Arsinoe.
Arsinoe, yeah?
Arsinoe, yeah.
Okay, and that's a Ptolemy.
The Ptolemy.
And this is Amun Min. And this is Osiris and Isis. And here is Maat given to Amun and wife Amunet or Mut by Ptolemy. Amun and his son, the moon. The moon sun is full moon and crescent moon. Amun again, and Hathor, and who's this? She's the queen, must be. You know?
And they actually the...
Arsinoe.
The Ptolemies were wildly uncreative. All kings, Ptolemy kings, were called Ptolemies. And their queens were Cleopatra, Arsinoe, and Berenice. And Cleopatra, the Elizabeth Taylor. Cleopatra was Cleopatra the Seventh.
Hathor, did you see a John Neptis here?
Which?
Here.
Beautiful Neftis.
And that's Horus, but this is a really nice Neftis.
Neftis, which you don't see that often.
Yeah, you don't see. And Amun is dark here.
Anubis is supposed to be, by the way, Anubis is supposed to be the son, in one of the myths anyway, the son of Neftis and Set.
Oh. And look at the baboons worshipping or hailing the winged scarab is pushing the sun. It's a beautiful scene.
Yeah.
Yeah? Where is Zeke?
He is.
Why?
Because he likes scarabs.
Okay. Okay, shall we do a bit of
meditation?
Yeah.
A little
bit. Oh, yeah.
Thank you, Savior.
What do you want?